So we need to talk about invertible programs. Look at these two beautiful functions. They can represent things like encoders and decoders, or they could go between two different representations of the same thing. But as simple as they are, implementation of these functions may be rather complex. So imagine if it's not one line of functions, but maybe 20 lines or even 100 lines. The way we usually go with such things would be to implement them and test extensively that this implementation match one another. But what if we can have one implementation instead? So of course it's not going to be a function anymore. It's going to be more like a program that exposes three functions. But at least compiler would help us to alleviate certain number of manual and tedious testing here by checking types, etc. So that's what the parsers library is about. I work on this library for the past year and a half. Right now, I think I just recently published, it should be available, a new version. And if I would say you that that library can solve the question of going from A to B, that would be an outrageous lie. It's obviously not possible. What it can do is help you to get between these two values. The problem of going between two different types, in principle, is it's very difficult. So category theory has an abstraction called isomorphism, and that abstraction describes how items can be in relations. So in category theory, we have just items without precising what they are. Specifically, isomorphism is defined as having two morphisms or arrows going between these items, but there is one very important caveat. Domains and codomains of these arrows, you think of input of one and output of another, should match exactly. Now, we are not in category theory, we are in Scala land, and we deal with functions and types. And here you can see that if we simply define our functions as something going from A to B, and then give some real types like this one. That's a very simple thing, and it's kind of practical thing. The GVM has functions like string to int. That isn't really possible, because if you try to convert something like 5, that's okay, but for some text it's not going to work. So there is a research behind this problem, and that research is done for Haskell. It introduces a concept called partial isomorphism. So the word partial is not a joke. It's actually, so I don't know how much of mathematical problems is broken here in mathematical series, but it does work in practice. So what they do in the research, they make the output type optional. So essentially you're going from, let's say, A to an optional B. It's very important for us functional programmers because here we regain totality of all our functions. And now you can see that I can go between, let's say, some text to a number. It's just, I'm not going to get a value, I'm going to get none. Parsers and printers are a very trivial example of complex conversions. But you have more real-world applications powered by the same principle. So let's look at the different types here. So what I'm trying to do is take some bytes and using the function receive, convert it into, let's say, a request. This would correspond to an implementation of a web server. On the other hand, if you have another function that takes a request and in some way implements a function send, which would convert request back into bytes, that would correspond to a client library for said web server. So the key concept here is the need here is only to implement once this problem and not do two different separate implementations and test them together. So this concept is inside the library that I built. And to this day, I thought, so this is the library abstraction, the only one that it provides. And today I saw that I will probably break a record of too many type parameters for one type. Unfortunately, Adam beat me to this with his test aspect, which has 6 type parameters, so I have only 5. Now, what is all about? So the grammar name is simply comes from literature, but basically, let me first tell you what is type parameters. As you may think, we're talking about conversion between types. So there is an input type, and there is an A type, which is an output type. As I said, it's not possible practically to convert values just between themselves. You need to get some kind of effect. Effect we use in this library is simply either. So the value that you get out of conversion would be either an error or a value. That's why we have the error channel. And finally, these are states. So it turned out that working with long-running conversions, or at least not trivial conversions, may require some state to be threaded through a computation in both ways. So that's why state is simply a first-class citizen here. Now, let me go back to the grammar explanation. So as I said, grammar name is really coming from literature. What grammar does, so the way you use this library, you give it some functions, some little pieces that are trivial to implement. Like, for example, you may take a piece of input and get back the rest of input in the value. Or you can map a function, map it to from one type to another. So these little functions is what you would get your library. And those functions are captured in the grammar. Grammar is just such a class that captures it. Now, the way you can run those computations would be to simply create a parser or a printer runnable functions, something that takes created grammars and composes them together and gives you back a function that you can execute, giving it a value. So I would, it may sound a bit complicated, as I've been told previously by presenting this library, so this is the simplest, dumbest example I could possibly come up with, which is completely impractical. So what you have to do is convert a string which contains digits into something that is a list of integers. And the way you do it is by simply breaking this task into smaller parts. So the first thing would be take one character from that string. The second part would be convert that character into a number, and then just repeat the steps until you exhaust your input or you error out at any stage. And this is the function that, for example, I can give to you through the library. So I have pairs of these functions because we go in both ways. So one is simply takes a string and then and gets the first character out of it and then returns the rest of this character. And the reverse is trivial. And the other one converts it to integer. And this conversion is obviously may not happen, so that's why there is a partial function in Scala. So now once we give these functions, the way we give them to your library is by simply using combinators. So that shouldn't be new to anyone. Think of it as an option. When we work with options, we give option constructor some values. Those are like real values. And then we can use some combinators to convert whatever is in this optional context. So here, the difference is really only in what type of values we can give. They are very specific, they are functions. And the fact that for grammars, you cannot really get the value out, you need to use an interpreter. So the library provides an interpreter that you give grammar to that interpreter, and then the value is only produced by the interpreter. And values are functions we can run. So it's like, think of it as option would be one step, and here you'll have to do 3 steps. But the principle is exactly the same. And this is how you produce runnable functions, and then the printers and parsers. It's just one line, call a module and give it a grammar. Now, I wouldn't be here if I would simply go and show you that simple example and be it. That's not really interesting. What's interesting is how you can use it in practice for a real-world application. So in my case, the example I picked, and it's a real example, so it's actually from almost from the work I do. What I'd like to do is take some program text and convert it into something that describes an execution path of this program. So specifically, I model this type as expression, simply an algebra with two inhabitants. One has a value that you probably get from the program text itself, and another describes you how function can be executed. It simply has a name and a list of parameters as expression as well. So you can think that it's also two example. What's the big deal? String two different inhabitants of an algebra. However, in real world, so this a little program here, you can probably just read it because it's very intuitive. It says compare one value with something taken from database using rules A and B. So what that thing is implementation of a real world rule engine. And those things are huge enterprise applications. If you ever worked with something like that, you probably saw how difficult it is to use them. So those applications are composed of two parts. One is some kind of parsing and printing of this, or maybe rendering of these programs, and the second actually execution of them. So the execution part is somewhere else. I'm not going to talk about it, and it's not in my library anyway. But the first part is there. And what I'm trying to convince you is that in order to build this enterprise level, maybe almost built, you would need something like 50 lines of code. So that's the example in repository that you can check out and just simply see how it's done. Now, why am I interested in cases like this? And another motivating example showing you that this is a real world application is the following. So let's say you start working with your data and data becomes program text. What would happen if for any reason you would introduce a compiler version 2.0 something else? What happens if your customer would request something, give you $1 million for that feature in the program text that he has in database? Or maybe you simply made a bug. Now what do you do? So what you can do is you can convert the source code into something that is understandable by computers, like that structure I showed you. And then simply because this unstructured data is no more, there is structured data, you can run algorithms and fixes on that thing. Once it's done, you simply print it back into text, and that text can be now user-friendly and stored back into databases and so on and so on. So here we go. How do we go about this use case? And by the way, that example in Scala world it has analogous use cases. It's called automatic rewrite rules or upgrades. I'm not remember exactly which library does this, but I know that people who maintain libraries sometimes provide migration tools, which do not use my library in any way. They simply follow the same principle of rewriting source code. So how we go about doing it? The thing is that what I will show you is probably takes less than 5 minutes. What you need to do with my library is define your types. So here I'm extending module and simply put the input type. Then there's the output that I discussed. And the necessary evil, the wildcard input Scala. And finally, I would put that type alias here only because I want to save some space on slides, although they're not that much complicated. So I will go on reverse from the bigger grammar to smaller grammars. The reverse principle of what I showed you is parsing module 2. So what is exactly an expression? It's something that is composed of a function and a value only because that's how I defined my expression. So it has two inhabitants. And I know that some people have a very strong stance on symbolic operators. So for the sake of not abusing someone's feelings, I have all kind of synonyms here. But in practice, the pipe, which is a try one, and if it doesn't work, try another, and there is a tilde, like this one, that means take one and then take another. This only comes from, the way it's implemented historically. All other parsers library you can look at would probably have this. I didn't see a library that doesn't have those. So, okay, so what's the function? A function is simply, if you look at the example above, it's a name followed by an open paren, the number of parameters, and a closing paren. And here you can go. So, name would be a certain number of alphabetical characters, because that's how I defined what name could be, and at least one, that's what repeat one stands for. Then the arguments probably is the most complicated thing here. So arguments would simply take expressions followed by comma and more expression if needed, or it may be empty, because you know functions with empty arguments are totally possible. Value could be these digits that I just parsed. Again, this is not the comprehensive possible values that you can parse, but for the sake of simplicity, why not use values? And then digit is a character that you would assert that it's being actually a character here with the filter function. Filter would normally work the way, as, let's say, option would work here. It's the same principle again, it's all the same names. And the character is a consumption function, so that you actually can do. You have to give it a function that takes, let's say, a string and produces a character and the rest of a string. So what I skipped, and this isn't 50 lines, as you can see, what I skipped is the mapping functions. So mapping functions here would look something like this. And this one is the biggest function in my example. So why does it look so big? For first of all, it's like two functions. So you need to go one way and the other way. So this one takes that number of parts, like expression, comma, and more expressions, and alternatively empty list, and converts it into an expression value. But if you look at it closely, first of all, yeah, it's two functions. Each of them is patterned much on the alternative pipe operator. And that's it. And if you're not sure that what you write here exactly, IntelliJ type inference works perfectly with these examples. So every time you just open a hint, it will show you which types are there. I hope it's readable because type signatures are big. Okay, we're done with grammars. So all grammars are complete, and now we can take the library machinery, give it the grammar I called expression, which is the final big grammar composed of smaller parts. We can produce a function that is a runnable parser. So that function takes, so unit here is state, because I don't want to show how state would work. Presentation is unfortunately too short. So that unit is our state, we don't care about it, but we take input and we produce the result, which could be an error, a string, or a value in the rest of input. Now, if you give that function a value, what it will get you back is this humanly unfriendly structure. It may be unfriendly to you, but it's very friendly to computers. And that's what's the value of the library. Computers can work with this structure really easy. And you can build algorithms that would work with this structure very easily, unlike you would build algorithms that work with just text, by using regular expressions or something. Let's assume we migrated it to something else, and changed in some way. In this example, it's not changed. So don't try to look for differences. And the printer is the same thing. You simply produce a new function using the library. Again, expression is given as an argument. So the grammar is taken by interpreter builds a function. We can call a function with the argument being this unfriendly data structure and get back our text. So text, program text is migrated, and it's really a program text. You can apply such rules to more complicated programs, but from, so it's a commercial secret, I cannot show you the real code, but let's say more complicated language with closures and things, take something like 200 lines of code. What else you can do, you can print out your grammars in a version known as BNF. It's a widely known notation that describes parsers in principle. This isn't exactly following the convention, it's more like extend BNF, which is a format for more complicated grammars. That you can inter-exchange this things with other systems. So this is also like a language of its own. And you can use it for many other interesting things, like annotations. If you put some documentation into a text of your server endpoints, then they will be printed in some way. Okay. So when I did this library, I invaded the space of parsers, which is really crowded space in Scala. My library isn't here. There is a really awesome resource that is called Awesome Scala. And this resource lists libraries that are very popular in the ecosystem. So at least four libraries here would be parser combinator libraries. Now the biggest used by number of stars would be FastParse and Parallel2. And what I'd like to say is I'm not competing with them. That's just my opinion. So you may have your own opinion, but in order to convince you that I'm not, I built this little comparison table that shows how these libraries are different in principle. So the use case I'm after is invertibility. And that use case simply isn't done by anyone else. So that's what I'm trying to build. Then there is this thing called dependency. So Z at the end of parser's library doesn't stand for zero. As some may expect, it stands for zero dependency, at least for now. And so I don't have any dependencies. I only depend on Scala standard lib. FastParse technically depends on source code, but this is also a library written by Harry Lee, so I suppose it's no dependency as well. And Parboiled depends on Shapeless, but with Shapeless, if you ever used it, you know that it's not exactly binary compatible, so you have to be careful with dependencies in the class path. Now the second important thing here is what kind of input I can take. This library, because it's invertible, doesn't work with simply strings like FastParse, or so Parboiled can work with characters, but those characters should be ASCII characters, say strings. My library works with anything. It's really up to your user what this A and B can be. Because simply if I want to go through other direction, how would I work with something else? You see, input and output are interchangeable. It's just that the convention that we call A to B parser and B to A printer, in fact, it's the same thing. So that's the reason I cannot really optimize it. So it optimizes your point that I don't produce anything extra necessary for like heap consumption or whatever runs in JVM. I cannot optimize the logic. Optimization of logic is obviously on the user end because it's the user who provides little pieces, those little input functions that work with small stages of values if needed. And the number of those stages is also user-defined. So actually, I just don't have anything, any parameter to optimize for. I have three takeaways for you. So first, Scala is really a great language. Thank you.